Our next speaker is Ruta, who's going to tell us about BCGs.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm basically going to talk about connection between radioactivity in BCGs and large-scale cluster dynamics. In fact, it's a question that we are asking, is there any connection? The outline of my talk is I'll first introduce what brightest cluster galaxies are, how special they are, and then we ask the question, does the large-scale environment in which they evolve and reside, does it affect the nuclear radioactivity in them? And then I'll introduce the sample on which we have carried out this study and introduce the basically the methods that we used and present the results. They are available in this paper for more details than what I will give in this talk. So what are brightest cluster galaxies? They're the most massive and brightest galaxies in the universe, and they all happen to reside at the centers of galaxy clusters. This is one example of an Abel cluster, where as soon as you see the optical image of a galactic cluster, you'll make out that there is this very bright, massive galaxy that that typically resides at the center of the cluster, and it has evolved over its lifetime by accreting other galaxies and mass, and has grown to really high masses. And they show peculiar properties in terms of their profiles. These cluster center galaxies could be massive elliptical galaxies, or they could also be of a even more massive and larger class of galaxies called the central dominant or the CD galaxies. And their surface brightness profile in elliptical cases looks like this, whereas if it is a CD, it has an extended stellar envelope. So these are the BCGs, and this is the famous Perseus cluster that we've been seeing. And this is just to compare that an elliptical galaxy in the same cluster versus the massive brightest cluster galaxy at the center. So they really look special when you look at them in optical. So they are typically 10 L star galaxies. So they are at the very highest end of the luminosity function of the galaxies. And basically, it is known that they are typically more tend to be more radio-lound than any other galaxies outside clusters or any other galaxies in the clusters. And I'll come to this point of them being more radio-loud than the other galaxies of similar stellar masses. And it's also known that their radio powers are typically between the powers of FR1 type and FR2 type radio galaxies. So we asked the question whether the large-scale cluster environment affect the occurrence of nuclear radio emission in these special objects, which are the brightest cluster galaxies, because the environment that they see are basically extremely different than what galaxies outside clusters see. For example, look at the densities of galaxies and the ICM that they see around them. And basically, this particular thing that brightest cluster galaxies tend to be more radio loud than other galaxies of similar stellar mass, which are outside galaxy clusters, tend to indicate that there is a role that this special position that they have at the center of the cluster plays a role in their being radio loud. So there's also a scaling between their radio power and mass, and we need to decouple this effect from that of the environment. So we started to work with the sample on called the Extended GMRT Radio Halo Survey. It is a sample of 66 clusters extracted from the all-sky X-ray cluster surveys called the REFLEX and the EBCS. And they are basically the most luminous clusters. This is luminosity, X-ray luminosity versus redshift. And these clusters in this sample belong to redshift range of 0.2 to 0.4, and they are the most luminous X-ray luminous clusters in this redshift range. So basically, this work we have based nearly on the data which were available with other motivations. So for example, we have used SDSS and DSS to identify the brightest cluster galaxies in this sample. And then we have used visual inspection of these optical images of the clusters along with what was available in literature in particular cases of clusters. And then we basically look for the radio information for the BCG using the All-Sky radio catalogs and the JMRT data that we had acquired in the context of the radio survey of these clusters. And then we basically use morphology parameters for clusters based on their Chandra X-ray maps to quantify, to classify them into merging and relaxed clusters. And then we basically find the radio loud fractions and the radio luminosity function separately for the merging clusters and relaxed clusters. So this is the overall idea, and I'll briefly describe this, each of these steps. So of course, the first step is to identify the BCG. If it stands out bright at the center of the cluster, it's the easy case. But given the mixture of merging and relaxed clusters, you can have complicated cases where there can be more a number of BCGs, more than one BCG in a given cluster. Because for example, this is a cluster where you have probably two clusters which are going to merge, and each of these X-ray peaks, this is an X-ray map, Chandra X-ray map, and you have in optical a massive galaxy at each peak. So in these cases where there was this complexity, we have considered both of these galaxies as BCGs and included them in our sample of BCGs. And there were these other bunch of clusters where there were similar problems, and we have used as much data that were available on these clusters to basically establish what were the BCGs that we were going to consider. So the remaining cases were more or less straightforward. Then there was the next step of, there were other cases where there were no BCGs in clusters. So basically either these clusters were so disturbed and over their evolution, they did not form a BCG, or a merger could have displaced the BCG so much that it is no longer basically seen in the X-ray gas of this merged cluster. So these are out of our sample because they don't have any BCG. Then comes the radio identification. In two of our clusters, there were extended radio emission, as in this particular BCG in ABEL 1763. It is nearly at the X-ray peak of the X-ray emission in the cluster, and it has a nice double loop structure. There were other cases where the contours are X-rays here, and the grayscale is optical, and there was a BCG at the center, but there was no radio emission. So in this case, we have put upper limits, and we have put conservative upper limits based on the 5 sigma of the NRO VLA sky survey, which is about 2.25 millijansky. Now coming to morphology, we used the morphology quantification of the morphology as a proxy for the disturbance in the cluster. So we have used the concentration parameter, centroid shift, and power ratios to basically quantify the morphology of the cluster, and all these parameters were found on the Chandra maps of each of these cluster. For example, this is a double cluster, and you can see that these parameters basically will quantify how disturbed the morphology is of this cluster. And based on these parameters, we basically classify them into merging and relaxed categories. So these are the criteria that we have used. So the concentration parameter, smaller the concentration means it's a more diffusely spread out ICM, and it indicates a disturbance as opposed to a relaxed cluster where there is a highly centrally peaked profile for the in X-rays. Similarly for the other two parameters, and these limits that we have chosen are motivated from another context where they were first basically established. So they are basically from the radio halo occurrence. Radio halos are these diffuse megaparsec scale radio sources that occur typically in merging clusters. So you can see the details in this paper of how they separate out. And basically we have used this to basically make two categories of the sample of clusters, one which is merging and another which is relaxed. And now we look at the distribution of radio loudness of BCGs in each of this sample. So among the 59 BCGs that we had in our sample, we find that 33 of them reside in merging clusters and 26 in relaxed. And then among these 59, there are 28 which are radio loud and 31 which are radio quiet. And now this is the thing that we are interested in. Among these 28 radio loud, there are 8 which are emerging and versus 20 which are in relaxed. And among the radio quiet, we see 25 are in merging clusters, where only 6 are in relaxed clusters. So already this indicates the disparity between the occurrence of radio emission in BCGs in relaxed versus merging clusters. So here is a distribution. Now, we ask the question whether this is just by chance. What is the likelihood that just by chance we have got these fractions? And that comes out to be, so we made Monte Carlo trials and established that it is not a not by chance, but there seems to be significant radio loudness in relaxed clusters. And this is absolute magnitude versus redshift, and it is all the plots are color-coded. Basically, blue are relaxed and red are merging. And you can see that there is no obvious bias. They all form fall in a narrow range of R-band magnitudes. This is radio power versus X-ray luminosity of the cluster. And we have basically eliminated those BCGs in which the radio powers were lower than the upper limits that we had. And these were used to construct the radio luminosity function. This is the histogram of radio powers. And okay, I will not go into the details of this. But yeah, this is the plot of the concentration parameter versus the centroid shift. And here you can see all these clusters are these are relaxed clusters, the blue circles, and red are the merging clusters. And the black dot at the center indicates whether the BCG is radio loud or not. So it is seen in this plot that there are about 71% of the relaxed clusters are radio loud, whereas on the other hand, 81% of the emerging clusters are radio quiet. This is the radio luminosity function for separately for the BCGs in merging versus relaxed. And there is a big difference in the fraction of radio loud BCGs that we are likely to come across in relaxed versus merging clusters. Now, to compare it with another result from the literature, it is known that the radio luminosity of the BCG scales with the cooling time, central cooling time for the clusters. This was by Mittal et al. 2009, and they got this kind of scaling relation. So we tried to see if our results reproduce this. And so we plotted this radio power versus concentration parameter. And here you can see all the relaxed clusters in blue. And we basically tried to see if there was a trend in this. And there is a scaling that we got P versus C. And basically, we find that since the cooling time goes as inverse of the concentration parameter, we find that this result is consistent within the within its scatter. So this is the ongoing work where I'm looking at the spectra of the BCGs that we have, and we are trying to look if there's any connection between the basically merging and relaxed clusters, whether they show any differences in their spectra. And there are some interesting things. You can look at the paper that we have published, and we have indicated these results, but we are working on these. So I'll to summarize, we extracted a sample of BCGs from the extended GMRT radio halo cluster sample, and we used morphological parameters on the X-ray maps to quantify the disturbance in these clusters and classified them into merging and relaxed clusters. And we find that radio BCGs occur about 75% of relaxed clusters, whereas more than 80% of BCGs in merging clusters are radio quiet. And we also constructed the radio luminosity function. And the message from this work is that we think that there is a strong link between the radio properties of the BCG and the dynamical state of the host cluster. Thank you.
Questions for Ruta?
Missed how you defined radio loudness. Was that radio to optical luminosity?
No, it was any detection of radio source, basically, in the BCG. So our limit is 5 sigma of NBSS, so basically 2.25 millijansky, anything that is brighter than 2.25 millijansky in NBSS. We have also used our GMRT data, and that's where all these, basically these points come from, where we had deeper data. But for the luminosity function calculations, we thought for the uniformity of the calculation, we have eliminated the very deep data that we had. So there were 9 which we had to eliminate from our final sample.
I think this illustrates why you should never use the words radio loud, because somebody will always think it means something other than what it does mean. Yeah. Do we have any other questions? Robert, has anybody got a microphone?
This may be a slightly tangential question, but the Bologna group, particularly Elisabetta Liuzzo, looked at some cluster center galaxies and discovered that on the VLBI scales, they had symmetrical parsec scale jets, which disrupted essentially in the nucleus. Is that of any relevance to what you're seeing here, do you think?
Majority of the radio sources that we have in the BCGs here are unresolved at about 5 arcseconds resolution that we had. There are 2 which are extended. Which one was this Abel 1763, which I showed, and there is another one in Zwicky 5247, which shows a kind of head-tail morphology. Other than that, most are point sources. So they could be these galaxies, which are basically the jets are still within the galaxy.
One question over there. Yeah.
I guess the implication is that if the merger activity and the radioactivity are related, but do you have a handle on the time scales? That is, you know, which one precedes the other? Because I'm asking this because there is a connection of, you know, AGN activity and star formation shutting down, and that makes sense. But if you look at it deeply, Kevin Schwensky and, you know, company, they have shown that, you know, the time scales sometimes don't match. So I was wondering if you have a time scale idea here.
In this case, of course, this binary kind of classification between merging and relaxed, that's not the real case. Of course, you have a whole range of clusters which are in early stage of merger, which are in late stage of merger. But I would say that mergers happen on time scales of giga year. And there could be many cycles of, meaning there could be a few cycles of the AGN, the radioactivity that can happen within this merging time scale. But the cooling, because once the cluster heats up, as it merges, the ICM basically will heat up. And that cooling time scale is also long. So you have time for the BCG for basically to be affected by the large scale environment.
Okay, I think there are no more questions, so we'll leave it there. We have a tea break next. If you can be back at 3:30, thank you. And let's thank Ruta again.